Blessings. This is Minister Ty of Breath of Life Ministry, and you have just tuned in to Destin, and I'm excited about the word that the Lord has given me to share with everyone on this awesome day. And I tell you what, I just want to let people know that God is really moving in this season. God is really doing some new things. And before I get into the word that the Lord has given me to share today, I just want to first just encourage the people of God to continue to hold on, continue to hold fast to the faith. There's a lot of different things that's going on right now in the world, but God does not want you to get weary in well-doing. Do not get distracted. Do not get sidetracked off of the very thing that God has set aside for you to do. How many know a lot of times that comes with us having to really prioritize our life and really take a step back and look at what are the different things that are going on in my life? Who's in my life and what am I doing and where am I going? Because I have to understand that I don't have time for any delays. I don't want to be the one that's holding up the things that God wants to do in our life, because we can hold up the very thing. When we find ourselves not in the right position, or when we find ourselves not in the right place, we can hold up the very thing that God wants to do in our life. So now is a season that we put aside fear, that we put aside doubt, that we put aside worry and what if it doesn't and all of that. But the Bible says that the just shall live by faith. It is time for me to walk by faith and not by sight. I can't go off of what I see, but I have to go off of what I know according to the word of God. And that is that, you know, if I continue to seek God, if I continue to allow God to renew my strength, that no matter what happens, but that I will see the benefit and the reaping of the things that God has for me. So, you know, now is not the time for us to be afraid that, you know, what if I don't succeed, or what if I fail, or I've tried it before and it didn't work out. You know, it's time to put all of that stuff aside that says, you know what, like God told Joshua, to be very bold and courageous. It's time for us to be courageous. It's time for us to be bold that says, you know what? I'm not going to let anything separate me from the love of God. I'm on a mission. And when I'm on a mission, that says that not only am I looking to, you know, keep my eyes on the hills from which comes my help, but I don't have time to allow nothing to hinder me. It doesn't matter what it is. So I have to stay on guard and monitoring the things that I'm doing in my life. What job have I taken? I don't know why God is having me to share this, or, you know, where have I moved to, or what type of extracurricular activities have I involved myself in? Because everything affects our life and affects our relationship with God. And I don't have time for anything to get me off track to where it begins to now take away from my prayer time, or take away from my time of seeking God. Because I really love the movie War Room. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because one thing that it really conveyed is that, you know, we have to have that special time and even place that I'm finding myself seeking God. That way I can get direction, that way I can get understanding, that I may know what it is that I'm supposed to be doing. So with that being said, is that I can't let nothing take me away from that. Because if I don't find myself giving God time, really, how do you know what to do? Really, how do you know where he's telling you to go? Really, how do you know what he's saying to you if we're not giving him that time? And so that's just what I wanted to share off the bat, you know, to whoever's listening, and just encourage you that, you know, now is the time that we continue to, you know, have that hope and know that God is getting ready to renew your strength. But he's seeking for such that will worship him in spirit and in truth. And that's what I want to direct our attention to today is, for one, I want to go to John chapter 4, starting with verse 24. And to worship God in spirit and in truth says that now I want to worship God with all of my heart, my soul, and my mind. So that God is seeking, I want to go, let's go ahead and read John chapter 4. Starting with verse 24, and it reads this. It says, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So God is calling for us to worship him with our whole heart. Worship being not only a way of living and a lifestyle, but worship says that sometimes you're going to have to give up some things. Worship even says sacrifice. Say, what do you mean, sacrifice? Well, some may be familiar with the passage of Abraham. And what happened with Abraham is that God had told Abraham that I want you now basically to get ready to sacrifice your son. And the Bible said in Genesis 22 and 5, he said, and Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the donkey, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. So this is what I wanted to bring out, that worship does involve sacrifice. It does involve you having to understand within yourself what really is more important. I don't want nothing to stand in the way of my worship. If there is something that has entered into our life that has taken away our time from seeking God in our war room, in our closet, wherever that place may be, you know, seeking God, wanting to get closer to God, I have a problem. I have to find out what that is, and I have to address it, because now I open myself up to the enemy to be able to get me off track and get me distracted. So when John began to say that they that must worship him in spirit and in truth, that I am at a place now where I must worship God with my whole heart, so that I have to make sure that there is nothing that I have in my life that is standing in the place, amen, of where now I'm putting God second. So God is looking for us to enter into a place where I'm sold out totally in my heart to God. So when I say in my heart, you know, I'm not really talking about my natural heart, but I'm talking about in my mind, my thought process, totally sold out to God, to where when I enter into the sanctuary, into the house of God, and I clap my hands because I'm expressing how appreciative I am with God, my clap needs to line up with my heart. You see, when I say hallelujah, or when I say thank you, Jesus, that I want to worship God in spirit and in truth says that my hallelujah really lines up with my heart, because I'm really sold out to God. I don't want to be an individual that I'm saying one thing, but my heart really is somewhere else. But I want to be so sold out in my mind that nothing can separate me from the love of God. Amen. So when he began to say this, I want to read verse 25, and it says, I'm going back to John. It says, the woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. He began to let her know that the one you're referring to, you're looking at, you see. And so what I begin to think about that is we have to know in our life, we have to be able to identify the voice of God. You see, she began to let him know that one, you know, he's coming, and he's letting him know that the one that you're talking about is coming. You're looking right at him, but she didn't even know it. And so I begin to think to myself, you know, and I begin to look at our life, you know, is God moving in front of us and we don't even recognize it? Is God speaking to us, but we don't even have a voice to hear? And that kind of shifts me a little bit to the place that I have to go beyond what I see. So I have to put myself in a place that says God can speak through anyone, no matter their color, no matter their race. It's not about man, woman. It's even this with people that say, you know, there aren't women pastors and all of these kind of things. I have to open myself up to say God can speak through anyone. But I have to make sure I have a voice to hear what the Lord is trying to say. Even in this time and age where God is changing a lot of people's lives, where you got a lot of pastors that used to be drug dealers and drug addicts and used to do a lot of different things. Even when you look at my background, God delivered me from drugs. I used to be one to sell drugs. Used to be, you know, on the streets and in the clubs and doing all sort of different kind of things, trying to fit in, really trying to find my way, you see. But that God will change, you know, our life totally around. And I don't want to miss the word that God has for me, because I don't want to receive from the person that I'm looking at, or I don't think they are worthy to be maybe giving me the word. And that will cause us to miss God. That will cause us to miss the very word that we need. I'm here to let you know that we're entering into a season that our word of deliverance might lie in the mouth of the one that we hate. It might lie in the one in the mouth of the one that we have not forgiven. You see, because God said, I'm going to use that person, all because I know that there's an issue there. And until you conquer that, you won't be able to receive what now I have set for you. Why? Because God don't want us to have no blockage. God don't want us to have no hindrance. He don't want us to have anything that is holding us back, that we are totally open to the fact that it says, God, you know what? Whatever you want to do in my life, whoever you want to use, I just want to have an ear to hear what it is you have to say. I don't want to miss you. I don't want to get complacent, you see, and I don't want to, you know, because sometimes we're looking at, you know, I'm waiting for God to come out of the sky and speak a word, or whatever the case may be, and or some of us that don't like listening to people. Well, I'm here to let you know God uses people. He always has. So those that want to be isolated and don't want to go to church and don't want to assemble themselves for the strengthening, I'm here to let you know you're going to miss it, because, amen, praise God, the strengthening that comes by the assembling, you have to understand that it's a selfless act. It's not about me, but I have to understand that what I assemble, now God can use that to strengthen my brother. So it's an unselfish thing as well, that I can go and I position myself now for God to use me to bless somebody else, or God to use me to hug somebody else, or God to get me outside of my comfort zone and to say, God, use me to bless somebody else. Just for 1 second, God, allow me to forget about what I'm going through. Allow me to forget about how I'm feeling. Allow me to forget about the things that, you know, are going wrong in my life, and let me let the love of God shine in my life and bless somebody else and talk to somebody else or pray for somebody else. And so that's something that I really wanted to bring out. You know, yes, there are some, which I thank God for now, technology, and you have TV and you have radio, that the word of God can reach those that, you know, maybe don't have a way to get to the house of God, or you have the sick, you have the shut in, you have those that are immobile, and now through technology and stuff like that, God still has a way to get that word across even to those that are in the most remote areas in the world, that when it comes down to the end, no one will have an excuse that they didn't have an opportunity to receive Christ. That goes to my next thing to say, no one is at a disadvantage. I don't care how your life started, you're not at a disadvantage. I don't care if you didn't have a mother growing up or you didn't have a father, you're not at a disadvantage. The reason is because Jesus Christ shed his blood on Calvary and died on the cross for every situation. He covered the board. He covered the fact that you came in a broken situation. He covered the fact that, you know what, you might didn't get the same love from your parents that maybe the next person did, but the blood covers it all, that says that I love you all enough that when you accept me in your life, I'm able to conquer everything. You see, I'm able to allow you to get past the roughest of the roughest of the situations. Not only that, but that others can see the glory being revealed in your life. There's something that I began to look at a while back when I look at the different things that I've encountered in my life. And a lot of times when it really seems like it's getting, I really feel like this is for somebody, when it really seems like it's getting rough, it really seems like, you know what, the fire is up. This is the most important time for me to say, you know what, I'm seeking God even the more because I'm getting close, because the glory is about to be revealed. God's getting ready to show somebody that that very same situation that took 50,000 other people out, but they didn't have Christ, God is going to use my situation to see that our God is mighty. And the very thing that, amen, praise God, the next person couldn't get past, God will show that when you totally trust me, no matter what happens in my life, I can get to a place to where I don't change. My worship, it don't change. My praise, it don't change. My prayer life, it don't change. Why? Because I serve a God that never changed. His love, it never changed. His mercy, it never changed. So you know what? I owe it to God that, you know what, God, I'm not going to change. You know why? Because the power now that you have given us through the power of the Holy Spirit, when Jesus Christ ascended, he said, I must go that the other may come. In other words, the comforter, the helper, which is the Holy Spirit that gives us the power to be able to get past any situation I may encounter in my life. It doesn't matter what it is. I don't care how bad it hurts. I don't care how bad it looks. I've got to understand that I'm not powerless, but God has recommended that I go through this in my life. God has seen fit that I will test your love. Because why? Because I've chosen you for such a time. God has seen fit to say that I will use you as an example to others, that they may see a witness that I have an individual over here that went through the same thing you went through. They didn't give in. They didn't give up. It's not to make you feel like that other person is better, but it's to encourage you that says it can be done. Nothing new under the sun. Everything we encounter this day and age, you see, it's happened before. Other people has gone through it. That's why, like in the book of Hebrews, the Bible begins to let us know that we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses that as I read the word, I understand that Abraham knew what it was like for God to give him a promise, for God to speak a word to him to say, in this seed, I shall bring forth many nations. Only for God to come back a little bit later and say, you know that promise, child? You know that promise that I gave you? I need you to go sacrifice it. Can you imagine? I don't understand, God. This is not adding up. This don't make sense. But for Abraham, amen, to what? Execute the very word that God has spoken. For us to understand in the book of Hebrews, where the Bible begins to let us know that after Abraham patiently endured, he what? Obtained the promise, surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. Understand that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you see, even though they were thrown into the fiery furnace, decided that I'm not compromising my walk with God, and I'm not going to deny who God is. He's able to do all things but fail. I'm surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. that I see that when Joseph in the book of Genesis was cast into a pit by the people that supposedly had loved him, by his brothers, by his family turned on him. The ones that are supposed to love you, I don't understand. But that Joseph came to an understanding that the pit, it was all part of the plan. You see, that God had to implement, that God could use his story as an example to other people. You see, so I'm surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, a great cloud. You see, that I may know that the road that I'm treading, others have treaded before. The road that I'm going down, others have gone down it before. The things that I'm encountering, others have encountered it before. It might be coming in a different form. It might be a different magnitude. You see, one thing for certain, two things for sure, it's going to affect you differently maybe than it affected the other person. You see, but I'm able to get past it. Amen. It's doable. It's conquerable because of the God that lives in me. So greater is he that lives in me than he that lives in the world. So I want to let somebody know, amen, today before, amen, I get ready to end this, that God is doing a new thing, amen, in his people's life. And I want to embrace it. I want to embrace it. You see, I want to remain faithful because I want my love of Christ to grow. Amen. So it's not that, amen, I'm in it for people, but I'm working out my own soul's salvation with fear and trembling that I may be faithful to God. Because when I'm faithful over a few things, he says what? I'll make you rulers, amen, over many. So in that being faithful, that says that I don't just go through. A lot of us can go through stuff. You see, I don't want to just go through, but I go through it and my commitment don't stop. My loyalty doesn't stop. My love doesn't cease. So it's the attitude in which I go through it in. It's going to be an attitude that says that I'm not going to stop loving the people of God. I'm not going to stop serving God. But God, I'm going through it knowing that, amen, in the end, I win. That's the most beautiful part about it. Is that in the end, believers win if we faint not. So before we go, I want to give you this last scripture. Isaiah 40 and 31 says that, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. So you keep walking. And when you feel like you're getting tired, God's strength will be renewed. When you feel like you're getting weak, saying, God, I need you to increase my strength. When you feel like you're getting worn down, cry out to God. Say, Lord, I need you to come see about me. I need you to come see about me, God, because I don't want to throw in the towel. I want to keep running this race. God, I need you. Amen. Remember, amen, that the best is yet to come. Don't give up. Don't give in. And you will see the salvation of the Lord. I love you all. God bless you and stay encouraged.
No More Fear, The Battle to Keep My Sanity by Jasmine Gilmore is a book that gives hope to those who are going through fear or depression that hinders their ability to have faith in God. These feelings are accompanied by a void, a loneliness, and a pain that feels so real that it seems you can't even go on living. This battle did not come to take you out. It came to prove your love for Jesus Christ and to survive to be a testimony of His power being manifested in your life. Don't give in. You win. Keep the fight of faith. Visit nofear-jasmine.com to order your book and help support Breath of Life Ministries.
lessons. At the end of this program, stay tuned. Jasmine will be featuring her fashion show, No Fear, to give you the confidence and the attitude that God loves me and He loves me for who I am. So if you can stay tuned for that, you will be blessed.
No More Fear, The Battle to Keep My Sanity by Jasmine Gilmore is a book that gives hope to those who are going through fear or depression that hinders their ability to have faith in God. These feelings are accompanied by a void, a loneliness, and a pain that feels so real that it seems you can't even go on living. This battle did not come to take you out. It came to prove your love for Jesus Christ and to survive to be a testimony of His power being manifested in your life. Don't give in. You win. Keep the fight of faith. Visit nofear-jasmine.com to order your book and help support Breath of Life Ministries.